Hello, everybody. Welcome to episode number 198 of the SoxProspects.com podcast. We are the web's number one source for information on the Boston Red Sox farm system from the Dominican Summer League, then Fort Myers, then Salem, then Greenville, now, then to Portland, and then to Worcester. And that's all the stops in between. Thank you for listening. My name is Chris Hatfield. I am the executive editor of SoxProspects.com, and I am joined, as always, by our director of scouting, who did not have to change leagues in the affiliate shakeup, Ian Kundal. Ian, it's yet another off-season episode in which we have a ton to talk about.
Yeah, it was nice that some baseball things actually happened. We finally had a little movement. Not much, but there was some movement, which was good. And it's just good to be talking baseball back in your eardrums, as you like to say.
Eardrums. I think I used to say earballs after the way. I think that was a Grantland thing. But yeah, we've got a lot to talk about. We're glad that you're all staying with us. And it seems, Ian, just a really quick note. A lot of people are saying that they are really appreciating how often we're putting out episodes this offseason. And that we've been able to talk, even all year when there wasn't really a minor league season to discuss. And look, we say we want to talk about what you want to hear about, but if you don't want to hear anything, there's no point in us to be here. So thank you all for listening. Yes. And if we can, provide a bit of positivity in what has otherwise been a pretty awful year for a lot of folks, that's literally the reason we do this. Sure ain't for the money. So, we're happy to do it as long as folks are listening. And speaking of folks who support us, Ian, we want to give a really quick shout out to our supporters on patreon.com/SoxProspects. If you want to support the podcast, you can go there and pledge a certain amount per episode. And as always, we want to shout out our $5 level and up Patreon supporters. That's Kyle Costigan, Tyler Woodrow, Jeff Trainer, David Nardone, Tim Harding, Deb Stanton, Bill Stanton, Deb Kendall. Ugh. I'm sick, can you tell? Evan Kirkwood, Hurricanes 1, Chris Fox, James O'Hara, Nathan Kenyon, Andrew Wallen, David B., Ben Burnett, Al Mendel, Kevin Catrides, Ben NRI, Paul Denyer, Lendl Martin, Cassandra Buchta, James P. McMahon, Stephen Gregory, James Bailey, and our newest Patreon supporter at that level, Andreas Gullstrand, who, look, no disrespect to our other $5 level Patreon supporters, might be my new favorite name to say in that list.
I would disagree. I think they all have great names.
Oh, that wasn't the disagreement I thought you were going to have.
No.
And of course, as always, send your emails to podcast@soxprospects.com. We want to talk about what you want to hear about. And we've got some great emails this episode too, Ian. So let's jump right into things then, shall we? Let's start with the news. Lots been happening recently. Let's start really quick. Actually, Ian, I'm going to flip a little bit what we have on our format here that you did, which is great.
Let's actually
start with the minor league affiliation thing, because that's kind of the biggest news. after, gosh, is it a year now of speculation? I think it's a year. We finally know who the 120, I think we know all 120. Did Fresno accept?
Yeah, because Fresno's accepted, okay. Yeah.
We know all 120 minor league affiliates for the 2021 season and beyond, in theory.
They technically haven't signed their play.
That's true. Okay, yet, but, that's a great point. No, that's a great point. Apparently, the player development licenses are enormous. There has been reporting.
Which makes sense.
Yeah, there has been reporting that owners are kind of pissed at some of the things that are included in there. Apparently, they are very one-sided. That said,
shocking at all.
Given that in the negotiations between MILB and MLB, MLB has been responsive to some of the points that minor league owners have made and requests they have made. I think there is hope that if they go back to MLB and explain why some of the things are just not acceptable, MLB will be willing to back down on some things. Yeah. So we're not there yet.
It might be this Friday.
Is it? I didn't know there was a... It would make sense that there's a deadline.
I thought it was 10 days from when they got it, but I could be wrong. It's sometime this month, though, I know. Yeah. That I'm sure.
And I mean, look, the teams are probably all going to sign, right? I mean,
they don't really have a choice. Like, I mean, the only reason you wouldn't is if your owner's going to sue MLB. Like,
right,
that,
right.
That would be the reason you
if your owner has decided that suing is a better course of action.
It has been reported, I think, by J.J. Cooper, who's been all over this the whole time, that one of the bylines in it is you lose your right to sue if you agree to this. So, yeah.
For anything, ever.
Yeah.
You can't sue MLB, basically, which, I mean, you know, look, there may be some question as to how enforceable that is, but you don't want to sign it and then have to prove
it. I would think MLB has good enough lawyers that they would write it in a way that's not challengeable in court. But
well, yes and no. We won't get into that because we just don't have the time here.
Exactly.
For the Boston Red Sox, the upshot is this, as you heard me allude to in the intro, the four full season affiliates are still the same.
Mm-hmm.
The formerly Pawtucket, now Worcester Red Sox, will be the AAA affiliate. The Portland Sea Dogs will remain the AA affiliate.
Yep.
Salem.
Say the Worcester Park looks on track to be ready for the start of the season. So
yeah, they've got a field. If
the
anything,
is down.
Well, I mean, and look at it this way: who knows when the season's even going to start?
Well, we'll probably talk about that on the next episode.
Yeah. I mean, it's just realistically, I can't imagine the minor league.
I don't see the minor league starting before November.
There's no chance.
But that's my opinion.
Nope. Because again, there's no point in having minor league games unless you've got fans to come to the park.
Correct.
And they're going to wait till people are vaccinated.
Or if there is, it'll be just AAA. That's the only affiliate I could see starting like remotely close.
They need a taxi squad. Yep.
Exactly.
That makes sense. We're going to have Worcester and Portland are the same. Greenville and Salem have flipped levels.
I'm going to mess this up so many times.
Yeah. Oh, the nickel jar. I've already done it once.
Yeah.
Like, not on the podcast. Not on the podcast I've messed that up, but like... in the Slack. I sent something in the Slack and I said Greenville and I meant Salem.
Well, and the thing is, it makes sense though, because Greenville is a significantly better ballpark than Salem. It's in a better location. It's a better affiliate in the terms of it draws more. Like, mm-hmm. it's just the better setup place for a high A team. Frankly, Greenville is nice enough that it could be double A.
Yeah.
Or even, like, it's a great setup there.
Great and town, so too. I mean, great, seriously, y'all, if you can travel there, go.
It's a great place, and it's just geographically it doesn't make sense really in double A or triple. I guess you could put it in triple A because Charlotte's triple A, but it doesn't really. It's not big enough for a triple A park.
No,
it's it could pass as double A, but it's just geographically doesn't make sense. But it in high A makes sense. I'm looking forward to hopefully getting back down there because it's the people down there are great, park's great, and I'm excited for them that they're sticking with the Red Sox.
We should mention the Drive won Baseball America's award for like best franchise at each level, or like a franchise at each level that did some kind of good in the community in the previous year.
I mean, they're
a model franchise.
Yeah, they are. That's why I think we talked about it on here a lot and when we discussed this. I just could not see the Red Sox dropping the Drive because the players, the front office, the coaching staff, scouts, everyone who goes through there loves it and says it's one of the best ballparks in minor league baseball. And that's just not a place you want to get rid of if you're affiliated with them.
No. Meanwhile, and I mean, you know, I always kind of hate having this discussion about them because it's almost like to the detriment of Salem. Salem's a fine franchise. The park is fine. It's a fine park. There's nothing wrong with it. I've been to plenty worse.
Yeah.
In, you know, the DMV area.
Oh, for sure.
It's a fine park. It's just, it's, you know, a smaller area. The teams in Virginia, like, I believe Salem...
It's geographically tough.
Well, Salem, Lynchburg, and Fredericksburg all dropped from the high A Carolina League down to low A, and whatever that league is going to be called, together, which makes sense.
Yeah.
And so...
But in terms of getting, like, players there, it can be a little difficult.
Yeah, that's, I mean, there's a Roanoke airport that's nearby, but nothing goes direct there, as opposed to Greenville is very close to Charlotte, even though they're in different states.
Yeah, I've done that drive. It's an hour and 10, 15, an hour and 20 minutes. It's a very easy
drive.
So
it's a hub. I mean, from Boston, you take the flight from Boston, and it's you're there. It's what, like, once you get from when you get on the flight at Logan to when you get to the park.
Like 2.5 hours. Oh, to get to the park, you can do it in under 5 hours.
Yeah. So... By the way, I apologize if I'm coughing. I've got some kind of bug. No, it's not COVID. I mean, it's just, you know, whereas Salem, it's tougher to get to. The problem with Salem, because I think the question that a lot of people had instinctively, and here's the other big upshot, we're burying the lead here, is that the Lowell Spinners are gone. They're basically no more. they, I'm trying to think of what we know that's, I mean, look, they're not announced for any leagues. They're not an affiliated team. It doesn't appear that they're going independent league. It looks like they're done. So we just don't know. We don't know what they would be doing. It doesn't appear that there's anything going for them. The Red Sox put out a very interesting press release along with their release saying who the four affiliates were going to be.
Yeah.
Saying that they are committed to keeping baseball in Lowell to the degree possible.
Yes.
It very interestingly did not include Dave Heller, who owns the Spinners.
I don't think that's a coincidence, and I don't think it was a coincidence that it didn't call them the Spinners either. It just said
baseball in Lowell. Some things that I was kind of thinking of, and this is all speculation. I mean, maybe, you know, they got rid of Futures at Fenway. Maybe you have, like, you know, Futures at LaLasher once a year or something, and you bring, like, the Drive and the Salem Red Sox up to New England to see Fenway, and then they go over to play a series at LaLasher or something.
That's an interesting idea, because it's just, I mean, there's obviously in 2021, there will not have an affiliated team. And with the way that the PDCs work, their 10 years, with the way Salem's contract with the Red Sox through 2025.
Well, no, it's the Salem Red Sox's lease for the park. Lease for the park in Salem.
The lease with the park is through 2025. It's just complicated. Unfortunately, like, I loved going to Lowell. Like, it was the affiliate I went to the most. It was the most convenient for me to get to. Mm-hmm. It was a lot of fun. You know, that's where you see the new guys, which is my favorite part of this, is, you know, going out and seeing those guys for the first time and getting those initial reports. And that's gone now, and that really sucks. And, you know, I feel for that community, the Merrimack Valley. You know, that the people love it out there, and it's meant a lot to so many people.
I'm from Salem, New Hampshire. Yeah. I remember their first season.
Yeah. I mean, just think about, like, how many things we've seen there. Like, Randy Consuela, like, Joe Antoni Garcia, Seth Schwindenhammer, Bobby Dalbec hitting, like, 900 home runs in 2 weeks there, Jaron Duran hitting almost 400, Andrew Benintendi hitting, like, 250 because he wouldn't swing at a pitch because he walked every at-bat. Like, there were so many good memories there, and,
Ryan Westmoreland.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it's – I've got a lot of memories there too. You know,
that was where I saw my first ever catcher's interference walk off. That was a fun one. catcher's walk off balk. That was the first time I've seen that. Like, so many things.
My first interview with a professional athlete was actually interviewing RJ Swindle.
Oh my gosh, that's a throwback.
Was the guy who followed. Was he following Abe Alvarez? I think it was the year after that. I think he was following either, like, Tommy Hotovy or Andrew Dobies. And he was the first, when I was interning at the Eagle Tribune, he was the first professional athlete I ever interviewed there. And it's going to be tough to see it gone. I mostly feel bad for the full-time employees with the Spinners. That were still there. You know, they lost their job. And that's tough. At the same time, we've talked about this. It was going to be really hard to keep a full season team there.
It just didn't make sense logistically.
They rely on parking that I believe is typically used by UMass Lowell students during the school year.
They share a stadium with the university baseball team.
Yeah, which is a thing that teams do, though. I mean, like, there are full season teams in, like, the Midwest League who do that.
That's just another complicating.
But it's complicating, And I mean, like, look, the parking situation there was bad even when the students weren't there.
Well, and that's the thing is, that was the biggest impediment to me is, other than that and then their geographic location on the new realignment, but just parking-wise.
Oh, that's the other thing you should mention is the geographic location. They're just not near anyone. The closest A-ball affiliate, I mean, they would have had to have been in that high A Mid-Atlantic League, and the closest teams were, like,
it was 400 miles away.
We're like Brooklyn and Hudson Valley.
Which are our grant. I will admit, our teams, they played in the Penn League. But
it's
still,
like, it was them.
That's closest. And then Rome is the farthest. And Rome was like 18-hour drive away.
Oh, yeah. I mean, they would have had to fly, I think, under the new.
Yeah. Another problem would have made it just financially unobtainable for the.
Yeah. Their division would have been those two teams, Aberdeen and Wilmington.
Yeah.
Like, ugh. Like that Aberdeen team, they played Aberdeen. They didn't go to Aberdeen every year.
No, they alternated. One came to one each year. So it just, it was tough for
Actually, no, they came to Aberdeen twice the year Song was with them.
Oh, was it?
Okay. Yeah, they came to Aberdeen twice. I think it was that they would only come like once or twice.
But anyway, it's just, it's tough to see Lowell go. And yeah, we'll see what happens going forward.
Yeah,
but I would assume this is not the last we've heard of that situation.
And if you guys have any questions on any of the, on any of that, you know, hit us up. You know, we can talk about specifics. Other news, the Rule 5 draft happened. Ian, the Red Sox didn't lose anybody, which is a win. We thought they might lose.
There was a chance, but
someone in the minor league portion. There were a couple of guys that we knew were available in the minor league portion of the Rule 5 draft. Didn't lose any of them.
Teams were interested. I mean, I know.
Yeah. The Red Sox. Yeah. The Red Sox continued to raid the Yankees in the Rule 5 draft.
It's pretty entertaining. What is this, the third straight year?
It's the third straight year they took someone from the Yankees in the minor league portion, and this year they took the player in the major league portion for the second year in a row, which made sense because they had the fourth pick. This year they took Garrett Whitlock from the New York Yankees, Ian. Whitlock strikes me as not just a guy. Like last year, Jonathan Arroyo, I know how to say his name. For some reason, I'm having a weird moment. That was a pure stash, a prospect pick.
Yes. They knew they had the extra spots, and yeah. Oh, no, they didn't know they had the extra spots.
They didn't know they had the extra spots. That just worked. They were just going to try.
It just Whitlock, ended up working out.
Whitlock is a guy who I could see filling a role for this team.
Yes. He's definitely more polished than Arauz was. I mean, Whitlock was up to Double-A with the Yankees in 2019. He had Tommy John surgery, which kind of slowed his development, but he's back throwing. You know, he's been throwing since, I believe, January 2020. Over the summer, or as of the most recent video he posted on his Instagram,
yep.
He's thrown up to 94 miles an hour, which is pretty much what he was before. Mm-hmm. Because he's a guy, he's a big frame, you know, 6'5", 190 pound right-hander. He's got great extension, sinker baller type, throws a four seam also, but he's, you know, mostly low 90s. We'll get up to 94, 95. So his velocity seems to be back. Breaking balls, he's got a slider and a changeup. You know, both of them are like average-ish maybe. We'll see. That's the thing you can't really tell on video, and we'll have to see is how I feel for the secondaries and what's the command like.
Yep.
But he's a guy who looks like he could fill a role, and, you know, he's someone who's a Yankees top 30 prospect in a much better system than the Red Sox is. And he is – I'm not sure it's a starting pitcher profile, but, you know, he's someone who I think they can keep on the roster this year as kind of that, you know, depth swingman option who spot starts on occasion, other, you know, comes in a long relief. And if he clicks, maybe there's more.
Think Brian Johnson and Hector Velasquez in 2018, like that
exactly.
role.
And I mean, someone he slotted in at number 30 in our rankings, so it's a nice value pick by them.
Yeah, I mean it's a nice grab. You know, really could work out for them. The Reds, Gus Quattlebaum, the VP of pro scouting for the Red Sox, did the press availability after the draft, and he said that they see starter upside with him. But again, that's starter upside. That's not saying they project him to be a starter.
Exactly.
You know, he's got to stay up for all of 2021 with the Red Sox. He'll be up. He'll fill a role. We'll see what winds up happening with him down the line. Maybe he's just a long reliever down the line. Maybe he's that swingman guy. Who knows what he turns into.
Exactly.
And then, Ian, the Red Sox made two picks in the minor league portion of the draft. You want to go on them for a couple minutes?
Yeah, the first pick was Tyreek Reed. He was a first baseman from the Rangers organization. And
big boy.
Yeah, I was texting with a scout during the Rule 5 draft, and when they took Reed, he told me, and I'll try to bring up what he said because it's really funny. And let me see. It was...
He's a big boy, big power boy.
A big dude with huge raw was the first thing he
said
to me.
Huge raw power being
what
that
means,
by the way.
And I just enjoyed that because it was very accurate because I started watching some video, including I put it up on my Twitter, but there's video of him hitting a bomb.
He flicks his wrists.
In Major League spring training last year.
Yeah.
And it was like it got out in like 2 seconds, and it was a line drive, but it carried and carried and carried. And that's, I mean, that's the raw power. Like, he's a 70 raw guy.
And to be clear, he was in like A ball last year. In 2019 started in high A, stunk, got demoted. They sent him to extended spring training, and by that point, the Rangers had a guy at first base at high A, so he went to low A for the rest of the year, and he hit a lot better.
Yeah, he dominated again.
He probably goes to high A for the Red Sox.
Yeah, but he's like 6'1", 250, which I love. Yeah. And it's raw power. It's a position they don't have a lot of depth at in the system. And, you know, he's got that carrying tool with the power. Let's see if he can hit. If he can hit, then maybe they got something there.
And then there's our Yankee, Caleb Ort, a Triple-A reliever. Don't really have a lot on him. Weird path.
Yeah, do you want to talk about that?
Didn't get drafted out of college.
I mean, he went to Aquinas. Is that in Florida, maybe?
Maybe. Didn't get drafted. Went and played indie ball for, what, like 4 years, I think it is?
Yeah.
And
through 2017.
Yeah. Signs with the Diamondbacks. Doesn't make it out of camp with them. Re-signs with his indie league team, but then signs with the Yankees in May.
Yep.
And, like, has gotten up to AAA. That's in, what, 17, I think?
Yeah, he signed in 2017. He made his professional debut, and he's been good.
He got up to AAA in 2019. He's old. He's, like, what, 29,
I think? Yeah, he's 28 right now.
28 right now. He'll be 29 next year. Great strikeout numbers, awful walk numbers.
He fits the mold of the guys they've been targeting, guys like Seth Blair, Caleb Simpson, Domingo Tapia even. Just guys that they throw really hard. They have a pretty nasty breaking ball when they throw strikes, but they don't throw a lot of strikes. And you bring them in, you see if they can tweak a few things and maybe something clicks. And I like it as a, you know, a dart throw. There's no real – take a guy in the minor league rule 5 draft. There's no real downside to it. None. I think it's you have to pay $5,000 and, you know, the guy, there's no rules about if he doesn't do this, he has to go back or anything. So
it's a no-loss situation. I mean, look, you're not going to get – I mean, neither of those guys made our top 60. I could see Reed being a guy we put in like the 70s or 80s or 60s or 70s on our like personal list.
He would have been my just missed, you know, 10, 15 spots.
He's interesting. But, he's first base only.
The thing is, he's also 24 almost. Yeah. You know, he's going to be in the low minors. You know, we need to see it. But good, you know, Ort makes sense and Reed makes sense because as we talked about, first base depth is just not a strength of the system.
Yep. In Major League news, the Red Sox signed Hunter Renfroe to a 1-year, $3.1 million deal with incentives that could bring the deal up to $3.7 million. And Ian, this is an interesting part. It's actually kind of like a 3-year deal because he's under team control for 3 years. So that's kind of nice.
Yeah, I love it. I think it's a great move.
It's like a 3-year deal with no guaranteed money.
Which is even better. Like you look at, I think like Mike Zunino is another example. He got something similar today, except his is like he can hit certain benchmarks and then he gets a value amount for next year. Whereas Renfroe's is just, he just goes into the ARB system after the next 2 years or for the next 2 years. I think it's a great move. I love the flexibility it gives them because with Renfroe, he's someone who, yes, he was terrible last year. There's no sugarcoating it. I mean, he hit 156 last year. It was a weird year. You know, I'll give him a pass. But he's someone who's always hit lefties. He's got a ton of raw power, a ton of home run power, frankly. And his swing and game is just designed for Fenway. You know, you look at his out charts and the Fenway Park dimensions will give him extra home runs and extra doubles because he's just a guy who hits fly balls in the air and it carries. Mm-hmm. And that plays at Fenway really well to the pull side.
Yep.
And the thing I like the most about it is that the flexibility, as I said, he's someone who if the center field market doesn't develop – You could justify putting Alex Verdugo in center and making, you know, Renfroe your everyday or signing another corner outfielder to platoon with him in right field, someone like a Jock Peterson or something.
Yeah, Jock Peterson, Hunter Renfroe platoon as a fallback, I don't hate. I wouldn't like it as plan A, but I'm cool with it as plan C.
Exactly. And like, you know, they'd strike out a ton, they'd hit a bunch of home runs, they'd get on base, it would be fun. But the other flip side is if you do go out and get a center fielder, then you stick Keith Verdugo in right and Renfroe is the perfect platoon guy who can play some first base even when you need someone there to crush lefties. If you want to move Dahl back to third and give Devers a day off against lefties, or you can, you know, platoon, not platoon, but, you know, give Benintendi a day off against tough lefties, give Verdugo a day off against tough lefties. He just gives really nice balance to the current roster structure.
If Bradley is the center fielder they sign, which I think is plan A, personally.
I think so too.
That's you could easily spell Bradley against tough lefties and move Verdugo to center.
Exactly.
I'm comfortable with Hunter Renfro in right field at Fenway.
Definitely. He had one insane defensive year, and the other time he's been closer to average. But
he's fine.
I think the profile's fine. And yeah, I just think it's a really good signing. And it shows, I think you mentioned it, his ARB number projected was like 3.6 to 4.1 million.
4.3, I think, even.
4.3. Yeah. So they basically saved like almost $1 million by.
Which I realize the difference too, though, is that an arbitration contract isn't guaranteed. This contract is guaranteed.
Fair. But
so that's
the difference. Yeah, I think it's a good first move, though. You know, you're going out, you're buying low on a player, and there's upside, and he's under some team control. Like, I think it's a win-win for the Red Sox.
Yeah, and by the way, if your response on Twitter to anyone to that signing was, can he pitch, delete your account.
They will sign pitchers, don't worry.
It's coming, don't worry. Yeah. Really quick, Winter League update.
We should mention it does impact two.
Oh, shoot. Yeah. Sorry. Let's do that real quick. Yeah. You listed two guys, Ian, and I think it's very interesting. Michael Chavis, Jaron Duran.
Yeah.
You can start, and I'll fill in if I have further thoughts, but I'm pretty sure we're of the same mind on both of them.
I think he's playing the role that Michael Chavis would have filled it right now, and I just don't think Chavis makes any sense on the roster with Renfro in the fold.
Or,
you know, Chavis is someone who needs everyday reps, or at least he seems to play better when he plays every day. And it's just I don't see where he fits at all right now on this roster, especially after the Renfro signing.
I would say it depends what they do at second base. I think Chavis is competing for playing time there coming into the year. He needs to earn it.
Yeah.
I think you don't come into camps not giving him a chance. You give him a chance. If he comes in and he looks great and Arroyo looks terrible, then
yeah, but that's assuming they don't sign anyone second base. What if they go out and get, you know, the Korean player or, you know, sign Cesar Hernandez?
I think Cesar Hernandez would be great, but maybe you get someone who's more of a, you know, utility guy like a Kiki Hernandez or...
I think Jerickson Profar would be a great fit for
the team. You've mentioned that a few times.
Like, he can play second base, he can play outfield, yeah. But,
you know, it depends how you want the playing time to shake out. You know, maybe an injury or something, and you've got a role for him every day, like what happened at the end of the year in 2020.
Yeah, I just think it's tough. It just makes it tougher because it's another right-handed power bat.
Yeah, and he's becoming more redundant with every move.
Yeah. And then I think the other guy it impacts is Jaron Duran. I think this closes the door, as we talked about, that there's no way Duran was making the team out of camp. You know, he's someone who he has a lot of work to do with his new swing. We've never seen it tested in a consistent game environment where pitchers are actually watching film and making adjustments to it. You know, his first live sessions or reps are kind of coming right now, which we'll talk about, I think, in a second in the Winter League action. But yeah, this buys him more time to develop, which I think he needs.
Yeah, I think that's no question. Like you said, I don't think there was any chance of that. But, I mean, I guess in theory, you could say that he's the starting center fielder to start the year. So, I don't know that it really – I think it's further evidence. I don't think it shuts the door yet. But I don't disagree with your point.
He's not starting the season as center fielder.
Well, right. I mean, that's the thing. He's not ready to take that over. And they're not going to hand it to him, put it that way. But that's a good transition, Ian, as you said, to Fall and Winter League update. We'll do this really quick. The biggest news since our last episode where we discussed this, the Puerto Rican League started on December 8th. Jaron Duran is one of two Red Sox minor leaguers in Puerto Rico. The other one is Alan Marrero, the catcher, who he actually hasn't played yet. So Duran's the only one playing. He's an everyday outfielder for Caguas that's managed by Ramon Vasquez, one of the Red Sox coaches. JT Watkins is also working for that team over the winter. One of the Red Sox advanced scouts who you may recall from such films as the Red Sox sign stealing scandal. Duran off to a very weird start in his first 19 at bats. He's hitting 105. That's two hits. But he's getting on base at a 320 clip. It really looks like a lot of small sample size ball and play luck. We'll see how it plays out.
I've watched some of their games. Yep. There's not a lot of strikes being thrown.
All right. Yeah, that sounds right. That sounds right. And the thing is, the one thing that's worth mentioning is that power hasn't shown up. But again, if you don't get strikes to hit, you're not hitting the ball far. Hence the 320 on base, despite a 105 average. So he's playing there. A couple more updates. I think I had mentioned on a previous episode, Denny Reyes has been shoving, or had been shoving, in his first three starts. He hadn't given up a run in 13 innings, 12 strikeouts to one walk, a whip below five, a whip of 0.46. Unfortunately, he's on the IL with an oblique injury. So who knows when he'll be back. I'm sure the Red Sox are going to ask his team, Escogido, to lay off, you know, don't rush him back as much as they want him to get reps. So we'll see how long it takes him to come back. Other guys playing regularly, Davey Grillon, the catcher, is in the Dominican League. Johan Mieses is a backup outfielder. Cesar Puello, the recently re-signed Cesar Puello, we forgot to mention.
You mean Joey Mieses or Johan?
Johan Mieses. They're two different people.
Oh, Joey Mieses is a different player.
Because they signed basically at the same time last year as minor league free agents. Johan Mieses is an outfielder who is playing in the Dominican, and he has like six at-bats. Joey Mieses, who is playing in Mexico and is the only Red Sox player playing regularly in Mexico, is playing very well. 266, 323, 414 line, five home runs and 169 at-bats.
Yeah.
New contender for best winter league nickname. We mentioned Davey Grillon is named El Pupo, the octopus. Joey Mieses, I saw his team put a wonderful graphic. Look on my Twitter feed if you want to find it. Caballo is the word for horse in Spanish. They call him Caballoy.
Okay, that's pretty good. I still think El Pupo is better. But
I like Caballoy. Perfect. I don't do the inflection right on the double L, but it works. Trust me. I mean, that's pretty great. And then the Australian League starts now-ish, actually. The first game should be starting in, is that like 3 o'clock in Australia, and they're 8 hours behind us on the East Coast. So that first pitch is happening now-ish. Colin Willis is down there playing for Melbourne, as well as there's a couple of former Red Sox down there, including one you may have heard of named Manny Ramirez.
Yeah, I read that article today.
He's playing in Sydney, and it's tremendous. Did you see the videos of him seeing people wearing Red Sox hats? It's happened twice so far. And he tries to talk to them, and they don't know who he is.
Yeah, it's funny.
It's phenomenal. The guy's like, oh, my girlfriend. It's just, it's tremendous.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's okay. That's too much.
Well, there's also there's some pitchers playing too.
Reynel Espinal and Joel Pine, who is one of the former Yankees minor league Rule 5 picks for the Red Sox have made, and Joel Piamps are pitching in the Dominican Summer League. Down in Venezuela, Adanier Mosqueda is pitching out of the bullpen for Anzo Ategui. He picked up his first save the other day. He's thrown about five innings. Johnny Pareda, the catcher the Red Sox got from the Cubs, he's actually been starting for Caracas, flipping between DH and catcher, hitting 328, 427, 438, and 64 at-bats. So he's hitting really well, which is a good sign. Probably no coincidence that he was at the alternate training site.
Yeah.
So he's been getting reps. He's not rusty. He's been hitting very well. And I don't know if I mention Roniel Raudes last time, Ian?
No.
Roniel Raudes, another injury victim down in Nicaragua. He left his team with an injury. So it sounds like his season is done. Not a good sign for a guy coming back from Tommy John. We don't know what it is. It could just be a minor injury and he's being pulled for precautionary reasons. But yeah, he could be injured. And Nixon Munoz is also pitching down there as well. So you can go to the fall winter page and on the site, and they've got everything up there. All right. Rankings. Our new site rankings went up. Actually, it was at the beginning of November, Ian. They've been up for like a month, and we just haven't talked about them.
No, they went up mid-November, I thought.
Oh, no, they went up like right before Thanksgiving. That's right.
Yeah,
never mind.
Like, it was like, yes. No, it wasn't that.
We didn't talk about them last episode because we had Alex on, but our season-end rankings are up, Ian. I like where we came out. It was, as we mentioned in the conversation with Alex, it was really hard this year to do rankings with very little information, in part because we did have some information. It almost would have been better to have none because,
if we had none, we just wouldn't change anything. But,
well, exactly. But that's why I'm saying, like,
I think we had more information than I expected significantly. And
you think what?
Yeah. I was surprised by how much information we ended up getting compared to what was.
There's a lot from the training site. We got a lot from fall instructs, and the thing you want to balance, and that we talked about this in the last episode with Alex, is you don't want to look. We would weigh the fall instructional league a certain amount in a regular year.
Correct.
You don't want to blow up in proportion it's worth this year just because you have nothing else to go on.
Exactly.
That said, if that's the data we do have, we need to incorporate
it. You can't just ignore it.
You can't just ignore the fact that Gilberto Jimenez was the most impressive position player at Instructs. You can't ignore the fact that Jay Groom had a terrible Instructs and the stuff's still not back after Tommy John.
Yeah.
You know, maybe he just had a bad month, but like, that's what we've got.
And I think it wasn't – there were. I don't know if there's anyone who raised themselves like a full tier level. Maybe like some of the new – like Brainerd Bonacci or someone did. But I think a lot of it was more just reorganizing within tiers. And it's like, okay, this guy has moved up in this tier to the front of it, or this guy's moved down this tier a little bit.
There were some guys who moved up, I think, and we could talk about them as we go through. Maybe the way we could do this, Ian, really quick is – you know, go like 10 at a time. Is there anyone? I'll pull up a guy, pull out a guy or two. I want to talk about. You could do the same if you want.
Sure.
And if you, obviously the full rankings are at SoxProspects.com. We're not going to read them all here. You don't listen to this to have us read names. You know, obviously I mentioned Jimenez in the top 10, he's up to 5. I mean, to me, the big one, and we talked about this a lot with Alex on the last episode, so we don't really need to go too deep, but I think Aldo Ramirez did make a jump up. Ian, I don't think there's really any, I don't think you can really say he didn't. Not that I'm saying you said that, but I think you have to say he did.
Yeah.
It was a V-low jump. He was impressive. Go ahead. Sorry.
Yeah, I was just going to say he was impressive. And I think he kind of separated himself, or not separated, he separated himself from the low minors, other like pitching prospects, and kind of put himself in that other group that the Thad Ward, Connor Siebold, Noah Song, Jay Groom. He's right with that group now, I think, confidently. And, I mean, he's ahead of some of those guys for – I don't think there's many questions about him as someone like Noah Song or Jay Groom, which is kind of weird to say about a 19-year-old, right. But that's just kind of where we are right now.
They probably both have better upside, I think it would be fair, to, especially Song for sure. Groom, maybe.
I don't
we'll
know
see what the stuff looks
is.
Like.
Yeah. Groom's upside is you could flip a coin and I believe you with anything you say. Like it's just there's a lot going on there.
Yeah, he just needs the stuff to come back. But yeah, I mean that. Look, I mean we've got a from 7 to 12 are all pitchers. I think Hauk has probably separated himself from that group by the showing he had in the majors. That's not to say that he's like light years better.
Well, no, I think we talked about it with Alex. Like, yeah. It says a lot that, you know, now there's a chance he can start. You know, before, as Alex kind of said, he was pretty resigned to the fact that he was going to be a reliever. Mm-hmm. Now there's a chance he can start, but there's still question marks there. He has to develop that third pitch, and that's why he's not any higher, even though he was so good in those three starts.
Yeah, and I just don't think – I mean, look, we've talked a lot about those guys in the top 10. Maybe a little bit interesting. We talked a little bit about Noah Song with Alex. He's at 11 now. If you really wanted to argue with me and say he should be at like, you know, 5 or 6, I wouldn't begrudge you that opinion. But really, it's a lot of shakedown of the. To me, the interesting part is this position player tier that you kind of had forming with Chris Murphy rudely interrupting at number 18. But like, it's position players from 13 to 20. And actually, how far do they go on to the second page?
No, it's all pitchers.
Yeah, I mean, you've got Connor Wong at 21 and then pitchers, which catchers are different to me. But, yeah, I mean, it's, you know, York at 13, Bonacci at 14, Rosario at 15, Lugo at 16, Potts at 17, Jordan at 19. Decker's a little different at 20 because the point I want to make about York, Bonacci, Rosario, Potts, Jordan, we haven't seen any of those guys in person.
Nope.
Or at all in some cases, actually in all of them.
No,
I've never seen any of them.
I've seen Lugo.
I'm saying I've never seen any of them. You got a brief look at Lugo.
I saw him for like 3 games.
You did? Okay.
Yeah, with Lowell.
But there's just, I mean, maybe we go to spring training next year, hopefully knock on all of the wood, and like we completely flip that group. Like I would not be surprised.
Yeah, I mean, Bonacci is kind of he obviously was one of the risers from spring from Vol Instructs because he was very impressive there. But if you told me that, you know, you liked Lugo more, I'd be like, sure, that's fine. I mean, yeah, I'm not, I it's between about even, I would say like 10 and 19 or 20, 19 ish. You can pretty much make a case for them in any order. Maybe 10. I think you can. I mean, if you really like Blaze Jordan, I think you could argue that he's like number 11, number 12 prospect in the system. So
I think there's a tier after 12 personally. Like we have our grading, that the 12 is the last guy we have rated as a 4.5.
For me, if
you really like Nick York and you want to include him in that group.
Well, that's the thing is, like, I think York is kind of above the rest of them. So maybe it goes to 13, and then from 14 to, like, 19 or 20 is more or less interchangeable. Yeah. But,
like, if you're going to argue with me about why Brandon Bonacci is ranked ahead of Blaze Jordan, I don't have a here is why. I have reasons why I did.
Yeah.
But if you want to say, I think you're wrong about that, and here's why, I'm not going to say, like, well, that's stupid. Like, I was like, all right, yeah, that's reasonable.
Exactly.
But it is interesting that position player tier is there now, and plus like Rosario and Hudson Potts are just in the black box, like we don't know a lot about them yet.
We have our scout reports, we have alternate site video, and that's it.
And those are two guys that they could be in the top 10 by the middle of next year, and they could be out of the top 20.
Well, because the thing is, yeah, with Potts, he did not really do much at the fall instructional league. Rosario did, and he was kind of meh, like it wasn't that impressive. It also wasn't a great showcase for him because he's not like a
he's not toolsy
guy.
Yeah.
No, he's a guy who will, you know, you watch five games and you'll see him do some small stuff, make some good plays in the outfield, and, you know, get on base at like a 350 clip, and you'll be like, all right, yeah, that's okay. But yeah. in an instructional league environment, he's not going to stand out.
Right. Going on to our 21 to 30, Ian, as you mentioned, Garrett Whitlock is in there at 30. So that's a new guy who slipped in there after these rankings came out. It's kind of interesting. You've got two Rule 5 guys in Arose and Whitlock in this range. Arose is at 25. Definitely got some arms. Brian Bayo, Jacob Wallace, Ryan Zephyrjohn, Edward Bizzardo, Jorge Rodriguez, Durbin Feltman. That's kind of the either guys that are starters that are probably relievers, and you look at a Bayo and a Zephyrjohn.
Yep.
Rodriguez, I don't really... He doesn't really fit that mold. He's more of just kind of like a really far away guy who maybe he starts, but it's not.
Yeah, Rodriguez is someone who he's dominated. He didn't pitch at the fall instructional league, but he's dominated since he signed, and he's really good. He grades out really well in the track, man. That's kind of his talking why he's there still, even though we don't have any data on him from this year.
Command control guy.
And then as you said, like Feltman, Bizzardo, or just pure Wallace, or all pure relief types.
Yep.
But the stuff is good, and the stuff is ticked up for Bizzardo and Feltman.
Take your pick on those guys. Although, I mean, look, you know, Feltman at this point, I think he is a tick behind at least Bizzardo, and that's why we have him ranked that way.
Yeah, I mean, his stuff is as good as Bizzardo.
Like, yeah. So it's, it's an interesting tier. Marcus Wilson in there as well. But that tier of pitchers is really what's interesting to me about that area. And those are all guys that, you know, I think with the relievers, as we've discussed, and I won't belabor the point, there's kind of a ceiling on those type of guys.
Yeah.
I
it's hard to put a true reliever inside.
And maybe put Chi Jung Lu in there too at 31.
He's someone too, I think, is a good example of not overreacting. Like he dropped two spots from where he was before. Might have been a little more. It was two. But with him, if he, you know, looked like that in the regular season, he would have dropped way further.
Yeah, the way he looked at instruction mean. Yeah. Yes.
Because if, you know, if someone comes over and they're supposed to throw 93 to 96 and top out at 99 and they're throwing 88 to 92, that's a problem.
Right.
And so that was one where we're just giving him the benefit. We're going to have to wait and see on him. You know, he came over what we reported or what we were told he was going to look like. He didn't. We'll see what happens next year hopefully a more normal season.
He's at 31 because 2020. Yeah. Right. I mean, that's it. I mean, if he, you know, we don't think that people are lying based on how he looked before. This
exactly.
An unnamed scout comparing Engel Beltre and Oscar Tejeda to like Barry Bonds and A-Rod when they signed.
No,
because
just going off of instructs, he would be way further down this list, but we're not going to because as we talked about, it's hard. You can't do that.
Yeah. I mean, there's a reason they signed him to $750,000 or $750,001 contract.
Correct.
You know, it's not because he throws 88 to 92.
No.
One hopes.
So, yeah.
And then to me, Ian, the 31 to 40 group is just a mishmash of like guys going in different directions.
I think you could extend that all the way to like 52.
Yeah, I guess that's true. I mean, that's what you get after 30.
Yeah, I think really. 30 to 50, you could pretty much make it, or 30 to even like 52, 53, you could make a case for the guys in pretty much any order.
Yeah, I mean, it's just, you know, you have the guys who are moving up, you know, you have your you know, young players coming up out of the DSL, draftees like Shane Drohan, draftees like Bradley Blaylock, who really, he had a very short debut in 2019, but was very good at instructs. He's at 36. Mm-hmm. We should mention, I don't think we really got a chance to talk about Christian Koss, who...
No, we talked about it with Alex.
Barely, because it had happened that day. But acquired for Johan Ibar in a trade that was really to free up a 40-man spot. And the Red Sox traded, I think we had Ibar at 32, and traded him for Koss, who we put in at 37.
Yeah, I mean, and that seems about right. You know, he's not a high ceiling, but he's kind of interesting. We'll see what happens.
Guy. We'll see. But you've got guys who are on their way up, like the young Dominican guys. You know, Lopez is there, Luis Perales at 41, Darrell Belen at 44, Brian Gonzalez at 45. And then you have guy Eduardo Vaughn at 48.
Juan Chacon at 50. Even Brendan Salucci's a new draftee who cracked the rankings, who could move up a little more. Yeah. Like,
and then you have guys going the other direction. You have, you know, 38 to 40 is Brandon Howlett, CJ Chatham, Cameron Cannon. Those are guys that all need, like Howlett, you know, needs to kind of turn around the ship from last year. He was at instructs, right? And
he was fine. I mean, it wasn't anything special.
Yeah. Cannon.
He didn't stand out. Cannon was not good at instructs. I'll just say that. We don't need to belittle it, but I'm very concerned with him.
Yep. CJ Chatham didn't stand out at the alternate training site, didn't get an opportunity. At this point, it's clear he's not in the plans.
No, and I was thinking about that because I was talking about this with someone recently. It's like, what do the Red Sox do at shortstop depth for next year?
Yeah.
And I have no idea because, like, can Christian Arroyo play shortstop? You know, because I don't think they trust CJ Chatham at all. I'm not even convinced that he'll be on the roster come spring training next year.
Yeah, I think he's on the short list for guys that if they were to need a 40-man spot, he might be on the chopping block.
And I don't think they want Jonathan Arauze as the only backup shortstop. No. So I just don't know what they do there because they clearly don't trust Chatham, and I don't blame them. I mean, he didn't show really anything at the alternate site. It was a weird year, so we'll give him the benefit of the doubt. But something's got to click there pretty quickly, or they're going to need to go out and get some shortstop depth.
I mean, I guess there is Jeter Downs in a pinch.
Yeah, but he's not a shortstop. He's going to be playing second base.
Exactly. So, I mean, maybe that's why Chatham is still around, right? If they don't have the backup plan there, you got to keep him.
That's fair.
So, we'll have to see. We'll have to see.
Mm-hmm.
Anyone in the kind of 41 to 60 range we should mention? I mean, there's Jeremy Wu Yelland at 60, who he's interesting. There was one way he looked at instructs, and then there was like apparently the track man and all that loves him.
I think Brendan Salucci also falls in that same camp.
Yep.
Where they're both guys who they grade out really well and on the models and the track man data, but the scouts and their on field performance just doesn't match that. You know, the numbers from the instructional league were not very good, and they're guys that, you know, they both throw hard, they both have really high spin rates on their breaking balls, but they have tough deliveries and they walk a ton of guys. And, you know, I was talking to a scout about Salucci actually today, funnily enough, because I was working on updating his report, and I was just checking on a few things. And the thing he said to me was, you know, yeah, the stuff is really good. Like, I know it's good, but with him, that I don't care about that. You know, I care about the delivery and I care about the command profile. And I just don't know if it's going to be consistent enough to put a consistent major league grade on him. And that's why, like, he's someone that I really want to see in person. Same with Wu Yellen, to kind of see if they make some tweaks with the delivery and how the command looks, because both of them have the stuff to be major league pitchers. It's just, will they command and the other parts of the game get them there?
Yeah. So, yeah, I mean, hey, if you've got any questions about the rankings, hit us up, podcast@soxprospects.com. And that's actually probably a good transition, Ian, to our emails, right on time. So Again, it's podcast@soxprospects.com. We got a great lineup of emails today, Ian, and let's get right to it. All right, our first, actually, we want to get a Twitter question out of the way first before we forget, because it was an interesting question. Mark Herman, a guy who interacts with us a lot on Twitter, asks, what about a hot and a cold take on the free agent pitchers? Apparently meaning like the Red Sox signing them. I don't quite know.
No, I think it's the guys they're targeting, because Alex Spear has done a great job kind of laying out what it seems like are the guys
it's going what?
After.
Corey Kluber when he throws in January, Jake Odorizzi, Rich Hill, and the
Sugano.
Are you looking up his name? Yeah, Sugano, the pitcher from Japan.
Tomoyuki Sugano. And then like the second tier is like J.A. Happ, Jose Quintana, guys like that.
Do you have takes, Ian?
I think my first take is that I think Sugano might be like the safest of that group,
which is crazy to think about
that I'm saying that, but I think he's the guy I would actually go the most in on, because I don't think he'll require a long-term deal. I think it could maybe be 2-3 years, you know, 24 million, 30 million, something like that. Mm-hmm. And I just, you know, yes, he's coming over from Japan, so there's going to be questions, but I think at worst, he's someone who could be your innings eater, your number five starter.
Yeah.
And
which they need.
And the other guys just have such, like, Kluber, Odorizzi, Hill, all have major injury questions that I think they need someone that you can count on to throw, you know, 160, 180, 200 innings. And of the guys available outside of like the Martin Perez tier, I think Sugano is the most interesting. That's kind of my like hot and cold take on that right there. I think I combined it into one.
I mean, I'm trying to think of what the cold take would be, because the hot take is like
the cold take is you don't like the class at all.
Yeah, I mean, I guess. Yeah, I mean, and look, I mean, the cold take would be none of the pitchers that they signed this offseason are going to be on the team in 2022 or at least 2023.
I don't think that's that crazy to say that.
It's not crazy. Like it's boring.
I also think it's interesting that they haven't been linked with Taiwan Walker at all.
Yeah, that seems like I'm kind of surprised by that.
I wonder if he's priced out or something.
He might be priced. I mean, because there's so much upside there,
and he was excellent last year.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I think that's it. I mean, look, they're getting placeholders so they can see what they've got in the system and to see what they've got in the majors, because they've got
exactly.
In the majors, you've got the injury questions of Sale, Eduardo Rodriguez, is he going to come back? What's Nathan Eovaldi going to give you? And then you've got the, like, what is the Hauk, Mata, Siebold tier of guys going to give you going forward, and you don't want to clog it up. That said, Sugano for 3-4. Sugano's the only guy I would give more than a really more than a 1-year deal, but if I had to go 2 on some of these guys, or at least like one with an option of some sort,
I think him and Odorizzi would be the two I would target the most. But
you would give Odorizzi more than 2 years.
I would go is 330, but I would prefer like 224. I would rather overpay for a 2-year deal, if that makes sense.
Yeah, oh, for sure. And I mean, given the other guys that are available, I wouldn't go to 3 with Odorizzi.
It's not an exciting market, and as you said, I don't love it, but I just think Sugano is the most interesting there. So those are kind of my takes on it.
All right. Thanks for the question,
Mark. Thank you, Maximum Ham, for the
at Maximum Ham.
I just wanted to say his Twitter handle.
That is what
you want
to say. All right, we got a question from Brian in Nevada. It's long-winded, so I'm definitely going to cough during the middle. Hi, guys. Apologies in advance for the long-winded message. Something you said in a recent podcast reminded me of something that I had previously looked up, and I'd love to get your impressions on it. The two of you were remarking that the 2020 World Series opponents were both, quote, homegrown teams. I don't know. Did we say that? Although you both digressed a bit about the Rays, who often trade the prospects they draft for prospects that other teams have drafted and then develop those, or trade them for still more prospects.
They just did that trade.
Yeah, they did.
Nate Lowe.
The subject is obviously relevant to the Sox because of Heim Bloom and the state of their post-2018 farm system. At one point, Ian mentioned that Blake Snell was drafted by the Rays, which reminded me that I looked up his draft class after he won the Cy Young. Snell was drafted in the first round of 2011. Makes sense. Not so fast. Not only was he picked 52nd overall, there were 60 first-round picks that year due to the free agent compensation rules at the time, but he was actually the 7th, and then in all caps and an exclamation point, 7th pick that the Rays made in the first round.
Yeah.
They had 10 first-rounders that year. I remember this clearly.
Yeah, they had that crazy draft.
Apparently, the Rays had Taylor Guerrero, Mikey Matuk, Jake Hager, Brandon Martin, Taylor Goodell, Jeff Ames, all ahead of Snell on their draft board. Those 6 guys selected before Snell have combined for a total of -0.5 WAR thus far. 3 never made the big leagues, 2 are out of affiliated ball. I guess my questions are, What does this say about how brilliant the Rays are at drafting great players, and what does it say in general about how much of a crapshoot the draft really is? For one thing, they picked another seven guys after Snell who were not named Mookie Betts before the Sox picked Betts. No big leaguers, six of the seven now out of affiliated ball, and the only decent player out of 57 picks, of whom 39 signed, was Snell. Thanks for making it this far. If you have, Brian in Nevada. P.S. From the What Might Have Been department, in addition to Betts, Barnes, Jackie Bradley Jr., and Travis Shaw, Theo could have had Snell. Was it Theo? I don't think it was. Was it Theo still in 2011? Maybe it
was.
No,
2011 was. Oh, yeah, it was Theo. Yeah, it was.
Theo could have had Snell at pick 36 that year instead of fellow high school southpaw Henry Owens.
Yep.
PPS, speaking of Theo, he will replace Jerry DePoto in Seattle in 2022. It's his kind of town and fan base, and one of the few remaining white whale teams waiting forever for a winner. After getting the Mariners over the top, he will become the next commissioner around 2030. Theo Epstein's never going to be the commissioner. The owners will never allow that.
Probably not, but yeah.
Okay, here's the thing. The 2011 Rays draft is legendary for how they had a chance to overhaul their franchise and bombed and just failed miserably. I wouldn't use that as an example of the Rays being bad at drafting. They just had a god-awful year.
Well, no, but the thing is that they still developed like a Cy Young contender.
Yeah. Oh, Cy Young winner. Cy Young winner.
Just getting him alone makes it fine.
Right, but you would have hoped for one more guy out of it, right?
Like, yeah, but I think the one thing to take into consideration is that they weren't exactly like blowing through the spending like the Red Sox did in 2011.
And that's the thing, because in 2011
they were drafting on a budget.
There was no hard cap on a bonus pool.
No. So like they could have spent like $30 million on those picks if they wanted to, but they didn't because they're the Rays at the time. So it's like that, I think, is kind of an important consideration, is they were drafting within a budget. So, but yeah, no, I mean, the draft is not an exact science and teams are going to make bad picks, but it's better to have that many picks so that, you know, you can hit on a Blake Snell and, you know, save your draft like that.
They've got him as the Devil Rays still. The other thing that I was going to say is, oh, it's not going to be here, is it? Oh, no, well, it will. They have, oh, I don't know, 2019.
It's not on the MLB tracker.
No, I'm on BREF. The other thing is, bonus wise, I don't think Snell was like, I think Snell got money, right? Let's see. Yeah, Snell. Oh no, Snell only got $684K, but I think that was still over slot for that spot. Like he got more than the guy they picked ahead of him. It was a JUCO.
Yeah,
guy.
I mean, I have it. I have the bonuses right here.
I mean, Gadel got $1.5 million at pick 41, and then they went with like the next guy they picked only got $650K.
Right. So, But I mean, you look at, for example, like Joe Ross went 25th MLB guy. He got $2.7 million. The Rays took Gregory at 24, who got 1.6. You know, everyone else around him got over $2 million.
Right. They were trying to spread the money out. So for them, it was actually bad to have that many picks almost.
Exactly. And it's like, you know, you look at like 60th pick, 490,000, 59th pick, 370,000. But then there's also guys getting over $1 million in that round. So it's not like they spent significantly on all those picks, I guess. That was just the one context I think is important.
And for me, I remember it being an example of why it's bad that the major league draft, you can't trade picks. Because yes, the Rays would have packaged like at least half of those picks.
Yes, for actual players, for sure.
Yeah. But thank you for the question and the long email, Brian. Our next email comes to us from Pat Mahoney, frequent emailer. Guys, with the surprise hiring of Dave Dombrowski in Philadelphia, does this open up an opportunity for Chaim Bloom? We know Dave loves big stars and spending money. Could Christian Vasquez be in play? They need a catcher. J.D. Martinez, Nathan Eovaldi. Not sure how good the Phillies farm system is, but we know Dave has no problem giving up prospects. Could his firing with the Sox stop any potential deals due to hurt feelings? Also, do any bad contracts come to mind the Red Sox could deal for in order to get back a good prospect or two? Thanks, Patrick. This came up a lot on Twitter when Dombrowski was hired by
the
Phillies.
Jokes.
All of the jokes.
He does trade all the prospects, but he still wins World Series, so it's like it's worth it.
Flags fly forever, folks. Look, I don't think Dombrowski's going to refuse to trade with the Red Sox.
No, that would be stupid, too.
He'd be silly, too. I don't think there's like they know, I don't see where they line up for a trade at this point in time.
I mean, the Vasquez thing is interesting. I am kind of the opinion that the weird Chaim Bloom trade that could happen would be trading Vasquez and rolling with Kevin Pilecki and like Davey Grillon as your starting catchers.
Mm-hmm.
Because it would be something the Rays would do, is they trade, you know, an asset that's worth more because of his contract, who's not
30
good but not that good, for, you know, a bunch of really good prospects. But I just think the problem with Philly is I have no idea what they're not close to competing, in my opinion, and I don't really know like what Dombrowski's going to do. It's going to be very interesting because it seems like they're under financial constraints, and frankly their system is really bad. It's like worse
it's
than not the Red
good.
Sox.
Yeah, it's not a good system.
You're not getting Alec Baum, you're not getting Spencer Howard, and after that the next best guy's like Bryson Stott. I like Bryson Stott, but
yeah,
there's not a lot after that, so that's kind of the biggest problem there.
And as much as people are saying Dombrowski trades all the prospects, like, he didn't trade Andrew Benintendi, he didn't trade Rafael Devers, there were guys who he held on to.
Exactly.
He was smart with the ones he did hold on to. So,
exactly.
If anything, you want to be wary of trading with Dombrowski.
Yeah. And then in terms of your other question about the bad contracts, I do think we could see it. I think, you know, the teams you're going to target are the teams that have had their owners
there
literally
are other
come
emails.
Out. And...
Wait.
Oh, okay.
Wait on that. He was saying bad contracts. I presume he meant with the Phillies in this season.
No, I think he meant with anyone. But okay, yeah. Well, I'll wait.
Maybe this was the email then. But thanks for the email. Yeah, here we go. Next email is from Raul. He says, "Hello, guys. Which one would you prefer the Red Sox do? Take on Jason Hayward's contract, 3 years, $65 million, if it gets them Cubs number one prospect Braylon Marquez, or take on Elvis Andrews' contract, 3 years, $43 million, if it gets them Cole Wynn and Hans Krauss from the Rangers?" I don't think either of those would happen.
I mean, if I had to, I'd take Jason Hayward's, because I think Jason Hayward is actually not that bad anymore. You know,
do you think he would fit?
Yeah, he'd play right field. You put Verdugo in center.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's true.
I mean, he was last year. Jason Hayward was, what did he hit? He hit 265, 392, 456.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, it's not great, but it's usable. And, you know, we know he's an above average defender.
Yeah.
And Elvis Andrews just doesn't have a, I mean, I guess you can make him the everyday second baseman.
Yeah.
But the
I don't like Krauss and Wynn is fine,
no, that's but... the thing. And if you're taking on Hayward's contract, you're getting more than Braylon Marquez back too. Like, yeah, he's not good enough to make up for that salary, in my opinion.
Hmm. All right. Fair enough. You know about this stuff better than I do, so I will defer to you on that.
I mean, but like with Hayward, the last 3 years has been a 2 WAR player, and that was including 2 WAR in a 50-game sample. So he's not like terrible.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Fair. All right, Raul sends us another email, but since this one is also short, we'll read it, and it's along the same lines. It says, "I was thinking about how to fill multiple needs with one trade, and I came up with this three-team trade, and I wanted your opinion." You ready, Ian?
I love a three-team trade.
There's no chance this happens, is my take, but we'll see what you think. The Rays get Christian Vasquez and Hunter Dozier. Okay? The Royals get Shane Baz. Who's Padlo? Do you know who Padlo is? Should I know who Padlo is?
It's Kelvin Padlo.
Kelvin Padlo.
Rays prospect. He's okay. Like, I think he's like in the 10, like 10 to 15 range.
Okay. Jay Groom and Michael Chavis.
Okay.
The Red Sox get Salvador Perez, Pete Fairbanks, and Stomont. So in other words, the Red Sox are giving up Christian Vasquez, Jay Groom, and Michael Chavis for Salvador Perez, Pete Fairbanks, and Stomont.
I mean, yeah, if they would do that, I would do that in a heartbeat, but I don't see the Royals trading Salvador Perez. He's like their franchise.
No,
you know what I mean?
He's going to retire a Royal.
Yeah, like he's not getting traded. It's an interesting thought, though.
Yeah, actually, can we put this in baseball trade values real quick?
Yeah, go for it.
All right, it's actually going to take me a minute. I'll read the next email and I'll come back to this. The next email comes to us from Al Mendel. Thank you, Al, our Patreon supporter. "Hi, guys. Love the site. Love the podcast. Keep up the great work. Even after signing Renfro, I agree with your 2021 roster projections showing 5 to 6 additional signings to come. Those mean there are a lot more 40-man roster spots to clear. When can injured players be moved to the 60-day DL? That'd be Pedroia and Sale. Do you see the Red Sox waiting to sign their last player or two until that date? to prevent them from having to DFA borderline players they'd like to keep. Thank you, Al. That's during spring training. So there's a lot. That's a long way off. I don't think they're gonna. I don't think they're gonna hold off. But I think that that would do with like Sale, for example, is it opens a roster spot for a waiver claim, opens a roster spot for a guy who gets cut, opens a roster spot for a minor league free agent, NRI type guy who maybe breaks camp with the team because they had a strong camp. I don't think you're gonna wait to sign guys.
Yeah.
Next email is from Ben. He says, is it safe to say the Red Sox will have a top 10 farm system again after next year's draft? Seems like they've added a lot of depth in the 10 to 30 range and have some high-end top 100 guys like Downs, Casas, and Jimenez. P.S. question, is there anyone in the top five of next year's draft that you guys are particularly high on outside of Kumar Rocker? I think top 10 feels aggressive.
That would require for me them to either pull off like a couple trades where they're taking on a salary plus a good prospect, or for them to do something weird like trading Vasquez or trading Bobby Dalbec for a guy who will remain. I guess Bobby Dalbec is still prospect eligible, but like trading Vasquez for prospects or doing something weird with regards to that. I think they'd be in the 10 to 15 range though, because you know you assume the number four pick is going to slot in the top three probably. And then their second round pick, assuming they keep it, I would say is probably still a top 10 prospect, maybe 10 to 15 range, depending on who it is. And then they're going to have the type of money where they can move some stuff around and get another kind of high end player. So, yeah, I think like the 10 to 15 range makes sense.
And to be clear, I mean, that's if everything breaks right, right? Yeah. Like if guys have bad years, first of all, Gilberto Jimenez isn't a high end top 100 guy. He's not even a top 100 guy right now.
No.
If these guys come out and have bad years, like, I mean, remember what was the year that Mata, Darwinson, and Hauk all had awful years in Salem? Was that 2018?
2018.
I mean, just everything that went wrong could have. So.
Well, no, Mata wasn't terrible. Mata had like a 3.5 ERA in 2018, but he walked a ton of guys.
Well, they were because him, Hauk, and Hernandez were the top three in walks in the Carolina League.
I guess so. Yeah, his base stats were good, but the peripherals were really bad. But yeah, I agree.
Okay, our next email.
And then, oh, in the draft,
you can.
I haven't done as much. Like, I'm gonna start diving into the draft in the new year. It's kind of hard right now because I don't know when college baseball will start. There's some info out there, but it seems like a lot of the pitchers are interesting. You know, Jack Leiter, Jaden Hill from LSU, guys like that. And then from the bats, I haven't done as much on the bats. I've kind of just been focusing on the pitching.
It's like Del Castillo, the kid from Miami.
Yeah, but I don't really love a catcher in the top five. I mean, Judd Fabian is somewhat interesting, but I'm not sold on the hit tool there, which is I don't feel comfortable taking a guy in the top five that I'd have hit tool questions. Right now, I think it's just been focusing. I've been focusing more on the pitchers, but ask me again in like, you know, May, and we'll have a better answer to that one.
Right, right. Yeah, I think that's fair. Our next email comes from, comes from Dale. It says, first off, I just want to say I appreciate all the hard work you guys put into both the site and the pod. I think we can all agree the Sox need to add starting pitching. With the weak free agent market, I think a trade would be the best way to add that. What would you guys identify as a position of surplus, if any, that the Sox could part with some prospects from to facilitate this? Thanks for all your hard work. Ian, I'll let you take the first cut at that one.
Yeah, in terms of depth, I mean, I don't know. The obvious one is trading Bobby Dalbec to me, but I don't think that they have the type of depth teams would want for a guy who we could project as like a solid number three, number four starter. Because I don't think they'd give up Casas. I don't think they'd give up Downs right now. And then you're trading Mata. Wouldn't you rather just take a chance and see he develops into that next year?
Right.
Like, I just don't think they have the type of the system. And then you go to that second tier of guys, and none of those guys are anchoring a deal for a number three starter or anything like that. So I think that's kind of like a tough one right now.
Yeah, and I mean, who would you even be trading for, right? Like,
well, I think that's the thing, is we saw the pitching market kind of, Lance Lynn set the pitching market, and that was what we said, Brian Mata and like a Aldo Ramirez, Chris Murphy type. Mm-hmm. You know, and that's Lance Lynn, who's a 33-year-old who's got 1 year left on his contract. That's not what the Red Sox need right now. Like, that doesn't really help them. So I just don't think there's enough pitching available on the trade market because every team needs pitching right now.
I was hoping you would vamp for a little longer so I could put everything into this trade calculator, but that's fine.
Sorry.
We're getting there. We're getting there. Reading all these questions is killing me right now. I hope you all understand what I'm putting myself through. All right, our next email comes from David B., our patron on patreon.com/SoxProspects. He says, first of all, thank you both for your combined work on the site and especially the podcast. This has been a very welcome distraction for me from the monotony of working from home all year. I had asked this before for you to think about while putting together the draft retrospective series, but now that you've made it through the drafts that have no players in MLB, it's finally time to ask again. The question is, who would you consider to be the most impactful draftees from the era you have been recapping? You can choose your own criteria for defining impactful players, be it war, number of rings, bringing back the most important slash valuable player in a trade, or being in a crucial place slash time to help propel the team. Just a fun thought exercise with, quote, with mostly no wrong answers, so go at it. Thanks again for keeping us all engaged and entertained during this crazy time. Keep up the great work. Ian, I think there's one really obvious answer.
Yeah.
But beyond that, I'm curious what you think.
I mean, it has to be Mookie Betts.
Yeah, I mean, that's the obvious answer.
Yeah.
No question.
That's a great question, though.
Yeah.
I think, like, a fun one would be, I'm trying to look back.
Well, I mean, and the thing is, the era we covered goes all the way back to 2003, right? So, I mean,
yeah.
You've got players like Jacoby Ellsbury. You've got players like...
Well, Dustin Pedroia is another one.
Pedroia is the other huge one.
Yeah.
The other huge one, yeah. That's probably...
Jonathan Papelbon.
Would you... Pedroia versus Betts is actually interesting.
Because, like, Pedroia was in that with that first...
They both won MVPs.
Yeah. That's still crazy. That
does it depend on Verdugo, Wong, and Downs?
That's a good point, because Betts did bring more. The Betts trade tree is going to continue, whereas Pedroia's is likely going to end when he retires. I think it's still Betts, though, because Betts, I just think at his peak, was the much better player.
Interesting.
Like, don't get me wrong, Pedroia's been a great player, but Mookie Betts was... I don't think Pedroia was ever a top three player in all of baseball, whereas Betts is... or top two even, or even... He was never a top 10 player.
Well, it's impactful, right? It's impactful. What is impactful?
It depends on how you... Yeah, I just think that Betts had more of an... Betts, compared to anyone else, was more impactful than Pedroia compared to the replacements you could get at second base or in the team, I think.
Mm-hmm. I think that sounds right. But, I mean, yeah, you've got... I mean, let's look at the top of the page, really, right, is all you have to do at Sox Prospects. You've got guys like Jacoby Ellsbury, Pedroia.
John Lester.
Well, Lester was technically outside that era. He was drafted beforehand.
But Ellsbury, Buckle, Bogart, Jackie Bradley.
Papelbon.
Yeah, Vasquez,
Jackie Bradley. Yeah. And then guys they traded, right? So there's Kopech helping them get Sale.
Yep.
You know, you could say that Jalen Beeks was impactful. But to me, you know, Benintendi is a big one.
Yeah.
Pierce was Santiago Espinal. Sorry.
I mean, you could make a case Matt Mertin was impactful. He brought in Orlando Cabrera and Doug Minkiewicz.
That's true. Matt important. Mertin was huge. Although he was traded with Nomar, which was a big deal.
Fair.
I mean, to me, it's really the 1-2 is Betts.
Pedroia. I think Betts Pedroia is the 1-2, and then third would probably be, I don't know, would be third. Papelbon, maybe. Third is you could go a lot of ways.
I'd go Ellsbury.
Ellsbury, probably, yeah. The top two are pretty obvious, though.
Yeah, I think that's true. I think that's true.
Good question, though. That would be a fun one to further explore.
Yeah, I mean, maybe, you know, we're gonna, if it's someday, do this this episode that we keep promising, where we're gonna go, you know, in deep on the draft process that we did. All right, let me double back in. I finally got this trade simulator thing figured out.
Oh, good.
looking at the value, the median value, the guys that are getting traded to bring back, the Red Sox come out ahead, as one might expect.
No surprise there.
They bring in $32 million worth of median value and trade $22 million. Mm-hmm. The Royals get absolutely shafted, again, unsurprising. They give up $36 million in value and get back $18
million.
The Rays give up $27 million and get back $35 million, mostly in Vasquez, given because of the contract. So that kind of makes up for the loss of Shane Baz, who's the second highest valued player in the deal, actually. But yeah, the Royals, you know, they don't make up in quantity what they would be giving up in quality.
Right.
The Red Sox would have to give up something with somebody different than Jay Groom anyway. Jay Groom's not getting traded right now.
Yeah.
So, all right. Our last email, Ian, and then we need to go, is from Kurt. And Kurt says, "Hey guys, huge fan of the pod. It's another trade proposal, Ian. What would you make of a deal that would send Andrew Benintendi to the Astros for Forrest Whitley? I don't think I am overvaluing him too much because Whitley has also had his share of troubles for the past few seasons. With the Astros losing Brantley, Springer, and Reddick, there's a clear fit for Benintendi in Houston. I would assume this deal to be a one-for-one. Your thoughts?"
I actually don't hate this at all.
It's interesting. At first, I was like, hell no.
Well, no, at first I was like, there's no way you're getting Forrest Whitley. But then I was like, oh, wait, he's been injured. He's been suspended. Like, yeah, I mean.
In 2019, across four levels, Whitley struck out 86 guys in 59 innings.
Which is very good.
He also walked 44 guys and gave up 53 earned runs in 59 innings.
That's not good.
That's not good. In the Arizona Fall League in 2019, in six starts, he looked better. In 25 innings, he struck out 32 and only walked 9.
Yeah.
I can't see the Astros making that trade.
I still can't see them making it either, but it's interesting. I mean, Alex here, Alex had a great article on it. Benintendi just doesn't have trade value right now.
No.
And I think your best bet is you bring him into camp and hope he can regain it, and then you either flip him or you just ride it out with him.
Yeah, I mean, if he regains, if he comes back, then he's your guy, probably.
Exactly.
Right?
I mean, it's just, I it's an interesting deal, but then it becomes the question. Well, I guess the reason you do it is left field market is by far the strongest position, probably that and second base, the two deepest positions in free agency right now. So, you know, there's plenty of corner guys, so Ozuna, Puig, Eddie Rosario, like there's a bunch of left field guys available.
And look, Kyle Tucker is going to man one of those spots for Houston, so they really only need one or two guys.
And they've been linked with Jackie Bradley pretty heavily too.
Yep.
So
they're the primary suitor for Bradley.
I think
other
it's
than
them
the Red Sox, I think. I mean, there's been a lot that's been floated, but a lot of that sounds like Boris trying to create a market.
Yeah, but I think that it's an interesting deal. I just can't see the Astros doing it.
Yeah, I mean, the Astros just added Forrest Whitley to their 40-man roster to protect him from being picked in Rule 5. If they were going to make that move, I would think they would have tried to have done it before then, but who knows?
Yeah,
I guess if you're going to trade him for a 40-man guy, it doesn't really matter.
Well, exactly. But if it happens, you're a genius.
It's interesting, though. It's a really interesting because they also have, I mean, rotation-wise, like, yeah, they were kind of stringing it together at the end of last year, but they have all these rookies.
They have Framber Valdez. They have McCullers. They have Jose Acuerdo. They just got killed by Grinke still. They got killed by injuries and COVID last year. You know, like Acuerdo had COVID. Grinke got hurt.
Verlander got hurt.
Verlander got hurt. Like, yeah.
Yeah. Martes was suspended.
Suspended again, yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah, I mean, interesting trade proposal. We appreciate it. And that's it. Again, podcast@soxprospects.com. We want to talk about what you want to hear about. Thank you, everybody who wrote in. Thank you, everybody, for listening. For Ian, I'm Chris. We want to thank you for listening. Follow us on Twitter. That's @SoxProspects for the site account, @IanCundall. That's IanCundall for Ian. You can follow me @SPChrisHatfield. We want to thank Podcast Joe 2.0 for producing. We want to thank the Ludlow Thieves for our intro and outro music. Hope you all, I think Ian probably know more episodes before the holidays. So happy holidays, everyone. Happy Hanukkah to those of you who are celebrating right now.
I think barring something crazy, we'll probably reconvene either after Christmas or in the new year.
And this is episode number 198. That means we're coming up on episode number 199, Ian.
Yes, I can add.
It also means we're coming up on episode number 200.
Mm-hmm.
We don't have anything set. We are trying to get something cool for episode 200. No promises.
Well, no, we should promises. Probably end here before you reveal too much.
I'm trying not to. If this works out, it's going to be real cool. If not, we will have something that's cool. In fact, we just got an email for another cool episode that isn't even the one I'm talking about, but you know, could easily slot in there as well. But we're working on stuff. Keep your ears open in 2021, folks. We might be kicking it off with a bang. That's all I gotta say. Thank you for listening. I think that's everything, right? That's everything I gotta say, Ian? Yeah, that's everything I gotta say. All right, we'll be back in your eardrum soon, people. Peace out.